On leaving the Virgin Prunes, Gavin sought new musical direction. He met theology student and classically trained pianist Morris Roycroft and forged a collaborative relationship that would last 20 years.
It was a complex relationship and remains so, because we are so totally and utterly different from each other. Everything that Gavin does and wants to be and aspires to be and is, I really don't have a great deal of interest in, you know, and I would say after 20 years that I think it's fair to say that he doesn't have a great deal of interest in where it is that I would come from as a musician composer. And I don't mean that in any way in a negative sense. I think it's actually crucial in terms of our relationship. There was a lot of standoffishness at first, and yet respect, because when I first saw him on stage, I have to say I just instantly fell in love with his stage persona. He was just an incredible performer, which I had never seen before.
I wanted to work with somebody that knew and understood classical recordings or could read more than three or four chords.
I had this other knowledge of music, and we were bouncing at each other, and I was bringing him places he hadn't gone and vice versa.
Naked as sin.
In the early days, I was inarticulate and learning how to really express myself through music. I think a lot of my lyrics in The Virgin Prunes was almost automatic writing. I crafted the songs more and I thought about them.
I was still just a kid, my innocence was lost.
An album to me, or a song, it's a world, it's a place.
You're there.
Each man kills the thing he loves. It tapped into a kind of Irishness that hadn't much been explored in rock and roll. An imaginary back history of Dublin. It's a subterranean, louche kind of vision of Dublin as a port town, place where the sailors would come on shore leave, where there'd be prostitutes and storytellers and burlesque types. It also had a whiff of that old, weird Hibernia that, in many ways, separate from the Catholic Church, it sort of tunneled under Dev's Crossroads and went back into Stoker and Le Fanu and Oscar Wilde. Really atmospheric, beautiful, lyrical world that was also so decadent that it made most rock and rollers look like Mary Poppins. But a lyricism about it as well, and a romance, a very dark romance.
Just a penny for the pearl I ask, for a love that was strong and fast. Oh, this Judas betrayal was with more.
I have a voyeuristic side of me. You understand sort of loss, grief to a degree. You can see other situations and you can put yourself in there. Is the interesting writing or the interesting expression all to do with yourself, or is it where your head's at or where your imagination goes?
Nothing lost or gained, easy words for the brave to say.
And everyone's calling me the missing link between Nick Cave and Mark Almond, the Tom Waits of Ireland. I was being categorized into this sort of like mature goth that's grown up.
I see no hope in those eyes.
Each man worked actually very well in Europe. It worked very well in Holland and Belgium and around parts of Germany. And we built up a sizable audience there and confused them, as when we returned with Adam and Eve.
Me, I'm not young, me, I'm not old, the revolution fades.
It's a very, very confused album. Very schizophrenic, it keeps changing mood.
Me, I like that.
But that was me just trying to find out what I am musically and creatively.
I suspect Gavin doesn't think that commercial success is what it's all about. It's to do with his own artistic impulses. that's his objective, and he has to keep his eyes on that prize all the time.
Good evening.
I remember being on the road in America, and you go through that self-consciousness that fame gives you. Hanging out at the bus stop's different, or getting a taxi, and people know who you are, and you get a bit weird. And so Googie and Gavin would call me out on that, going, "You're very boring at the moment." And I would go, yeah, you're right.
He rang me up. We've just become very successful. We're selling a lot of records now. And I really, really want to see more of my friends.
We ended up not just talking about music, which would have been a divisive thing probably at that point, so we started to paint together. And it was also to encourage Googie, who we knew had not found a way to make the canvases really matter.
Take me back to 72, my cuckoo.
He said, "Look, do you want to set up a studio out here in Danesmoat?"
It became like a HQ. We would be painting there two or three days a week, and Wednesday night became boys' night. We'd paint and then go out.
And it was a wonderful thing for the three of us to paint together, to talk about art, to talk about each other's work. Where did that come from, you know? I wonder where that's going to go. I think we probably learnt a lot about ourselves as artists during that period. And yeah, learnt a lot about each other too.
Oh me, Lord, I'm so bored.
After two decades of writing and touring with the Virgin Prunes and the Man Caesar, Gavin was approaching a crossroads in his creative career that would be spurred on by a major upheaval in his personal life.
I met Renee, my ex-wife, say I was around 17. Virgin Prunes were just kicking in. She was quite shy, but then quite unshy. So there was a similarity there, in that, like, very feisty, very strong. And we actually looked very similar at that period. People used to think we were brother and sister. And we were both very intense kids and intense young adults. And then you live in something like a band, and a band like the Virgin Prunes gave you a license to not live in reality, but actually live out surreality.
He drew a lot from his personal connection with Rini. And it wasn't all sweetness and light, you know. They had a healthy, argumentative relationship, you know. And it strayed into all sorts of areas, weird and wonderful in his lyrics, that in many ways I think he took great inspiration from.
We got married. And then my work got very focused. I was away a lot. And when you're in different worlds and then away, shit happens.
You've taken everything from me.
They just came up, the two of them together, to tell Pascal and I. They didn't want anyone else to tell us, because his friends all knew. And I couldn't believe it. I just couldn't believe it at the time.
When you're in a relationship with somebody for so long, 21, 22 years, it's like losing a limb.
Just a shock, very big shock. Kind of had a feeling it wouldn't last. It was just different. The marriage was different. So he says, "I'm fine." He says, "I have great friends." Googie stayed with him. And Bono, when he was able to stay, great to him. and you never forget that, you know.
And he found it quite difficult to trust his expression and lyrics for a number of years.
You know, you're coming to 40, this happened. What the fuck am I? Am I a performer, a writer, a singer? Am I going to work on audiovisual? Am I going to work on score? Who am I?
Gavin's relationship with Jim Sheridan from the early days at the project came full circle with the film In the Name of the Father. Together, Gavin and Morris went on to compose musical scores for The Boxer, In America, and Get Rich or Die Tryin'.
A movie is essentially like an emotional box. Either you get it or you don't. The Irish are great at language, but when it comes to expressing music or visuals, I just don't have the language to do that. Music is an emotion mostly, so it's kind of you talk emotions and feelings rather than normal structured language.
Music in a movie, it's almost like this silent sleeping gas that glues the narrative and the acting, and it says the things the director can't say or hasn't said in the script.
He can put in one sentence the feeling of something, which then a musician can interpret in a way that will alter what they have been doing. That instinct of understanding when something needs to be followed or when something needs to be changed. And he's very good at putting it in a way that that appeals to something within.
Comes down to trust. It's real simple. You trust somebody to hand them over your baby. He's kind of even good for me, you know, just to kind of know what I'd want or not want, you know. He's a good kind of watchman.